Today and Wednesday, I want to talk about host defenses against virus infections. And this year, I've divided it into two parts. Today, we're going to talk about what we call intrinsic and innate defenses. So this first slide is an overview of all the defenses that we have available to defend against all these viruses that are around us daily. And at the bottom, let's not forget the physical and the chemical defenses that we talked about last time. Our skin, the fact that it's dead, the presence of mucus on exposed epithelial surfaces, tears, low pH of various compartments, surface cleansing like the eyelid, and so forth. These are the initial barrier against viruses infecting us. These are what we call the physical and chemical defenses. If viruses get past those, then they have a series of increasingly difficult obstacles to get over. The first is the intrinsic defenses, which we will talk about today in some detail. And if a virus goes beyond intrinsic defenses, if the intrinsic defenses do not stop virus replication, then it encounters innate immunity. And if that doesn't stop the infection, then we have the barrier of acquired immunity. And then, of course, if the virus gets over that, you have a viral illness, and hopefully you will recover from that, but not always, of course. So here is a more detailed view of these three defenses that we'll talk about today. We're going to talk about intrinsic defenses. We define these as always being present in the cell, in the uninfected cell. They don't have to be induced. They're always there, so when a virus enters, it immediately encounters them. And some examples include apoptosis, programmed cell death, autophagy, RNA silencing, and a whole host of antiviral proteins. And I will give you just a sampling of some of these mechanisms. I don't want to give them all to you. There's no point in doing that, but just to illustrate how they work. Then we have the innate immune system. This is a system that is induced by infection. And we'll talk about this today and how this works. It is not tailored to the pathogen, and there's no memory in the innate system. And as far as we can tell, it's quite ancient. And next time, we'll talk about the adaptive immune system, which is tailored to the pathogen. So today, intrinsic and innate immunity. Probably one of the oldest intrinsic defenses, now again, these are defenses that are always there, they don't have to be induced, is RNA interference. And this probably arose, maybe it arose in the RNA world. Maybe it arose long before there were protein-based immunity mechanisms. You'll notice that a lot of the defenses I talk about are protein-based, but this one is based on RNA, even though there are proteins involved. This is found in plant cells. It's found in invertebrates. It's in insects. It's in worms. It's not clear whether it's in mammals yet. So let's describe it, and I'll get back to that. So RNA interference, when a virus infects a cell, quite often double-stranded RNA is produced during replication or transcription. This is recognized by a cell protein called dicer, which, as you might guess from the name, chops it up into small pieces. And these are about 20 to 21 nucleotides long. And these are called small interfering RNAs. They are then bound by a protein complex called the RISC, RNA-induced silencing complex. And this sequence, this 21 nucleotide sequence, targets the siRNA to the viral RNA. And one of the components of the RISC is a protein called AGO for argonaut. This is a nuclease that then chops up the viral RNA. All right? So the incoming RNA genome provides a template for its own destruction. This is RNA interference, and again, it's one of the oldest forms of intrinsic immunity that we know of. It's not clear if mammalian cells have RNA interference for viral infections. We absolutely use RNA interference to modulate our own gene regulation, but whether we use it to defend against viral infections isn't clear. There's a lot of debate in the field. A few papers came out not too long ago suggesting that there is some remnant of this, but it's not clear yet. You don't really need it in mammalian cells because we have this marvelous protein-based immunity that I'm going to tell you about today and next time. But of course, that doesn't mean it's not there just because it doesn't look like we would need it. So RNA interference is an example of an intrinsic immune defense. It's always present. As soon as the virus comes in, it can be attacked by this. Now, another example is, I told you in the initial slide, there are lots of proteins that are part of the intrinsic antiviral immune system. And I want to just tell you about one of them here. There are many, many more. There's no point in telling you all of them. Just to give you an example of how these work. This is called APOBEC. It's a protein, and it stands for apolipoprotein B mRNA editing catalytic polypeptide, one of the most horrible names ever given to a protein, but it's stuck. And this is a protein that, as far as we know, is specifically tailored to interfere with HIV-1 infection. This is very interesting because HIV-1 only entered us in the early 1900s. So this has been around a lot longer than that. Now, APOBEC is it's a cytidine deaminase. It takes the amino group away from the cytidine molecule. So let's see what that does. If you, here we're on the bottom of the slide, we're making HIV-1 particles by budding. This is a process that should be familiar to you now. And these are incorporating the APOBEC3, which is the yellow protein here. We're abbreviating it 3G. So the 3G, the APOBEC, is getting incorporated into the virions. When these now infect the new cell, remember, the RNA genome is released, it undergoes reverse transcription. So here's the viral RNA in this little inset here. And you make minus strand DNA synthesis. We talked about that a couple sessions ago. And then the APOBEC deaminates the single-stranded DNA. So it changes cytidines to uracils. That's what happens when you take away the amine group. So now when you make this single-stranded DNA double-stranded, you see you're going to copy each U into an A, and now you have AGAA instead of GGGA. You've mutated the viral genome. This happens at pretty much every C residue in the viral RNA. So the result is the genome is trashed. It's not infectious, and it stops shortly afterwards. Now, we may ask, why do we have HIV at all if we have this great protein? And that's going to be another theme today. Viruses can get around pretty much every immune defense that we throw at them. That's why they're still here. If they didn't, they would be gone, because these immune defenses starting from this are terrific. HIV makes a small protein called VIF, V-I-F. It's shown at the top here. VIF causes 3G, APOBEC 3G, to be degraded in infected cells. It actually leads to the ubiquitination of 3G, and then it's degraded by the large processing complex in the cell called the proteasome. So in viruses with VIF, and all wild-type HIV viruses have VIF, they are produced without APOBEC, and they go on normally to infect the new cell. That's because of VIF. You can remove VIF from the virus in the laboratory. You could cut out the gene, and you get VIF minus HIV, which are then not able to infect cells because they incorporate 3G into them. All right, so APOBECs are incredibly important antivirals, but they don't work very well in humans because of VIF. These proteins, by the way, have other functions in the cell. And there's some interesting evidence now that when these get out of control, that's one of the important steps leading to cancers. So really important proteins. Another intrinsic defense is autophagy. This is a process, a tightly controlled process in cells, where when they're placed under stress, they respond by digesting themselves. That's where the name comes from. They're eating themselves. And what happens is if you have a virus infection, you get the formation of, actually what happens is parts of the cytoplasm are taken up into phagosomes. Right within the cytoplasm, you have these membranous crescent structures form. They surround the particles or maybe the viral genome. And then they fuse with lysosomes, which, as you know, contain lots of proteolytic enzymes. and RNases and DNases, and they digest the virus. So this is a defense triggered by virus infection. We'll see some of the triggers in a bit later. They're the same triggers that trigger innate defenses. But autophagy responds to stress. So you can stress cells in different ways. If you serum starve them or raise the temperature, they will do this as well. It's sort of a self-preservation mechanism. And viruses stress cells in a variety of ways, so cells undergo autophagy. Now, I wrote down here countermeasures. I have to remember to tell you, for every one of these defenses, there are countermeasures. So viruses have evolved countermeasures to autophagy. There are proteins needed, cell proteins in the cell that are needed for this process of autophagy. The whole pathway has been nicely worked out, and viruses interfere at very specific steps, so they block autophagy. They don't want the cell to be digested, of course. They want to use the cell for their replication. And poliovirus actually uses these autophagosomes to replicate its RNA on the surface of them. So it avoids getting into them, all right? It doesn't get engulfed. It induces them, or the cell makes them in response to infection. Then the virus replicates its RNA on the surface of them. And then it seems also late in infection, the virus actually gets taken out of the cell. So the fate of these autophagosomes, once they fuse with lysosomes and the contents are degraded, these then go to the plasma membrane and fuse, and they dump the contents into the extracellular space, almost as a way of recycling the cytoplasmic contents. Here, take my amino acids and nucleosides, some other living cell, and use them. And polio actually gets out of the cell that way. So many viruses can counter autophagy. Intrinsic defense is programmed cell death, apoptosis. This is a very specific pathway in cells. It is present to help us get rid of cells that we don't need or to destroy cells along certain developmental pathways, so it's tightly regulated. There are inducers and inhibitors of apoptosis. And one of the triggers is stress, just like autophagy. When a virus infects a cell, it stresses it in many ways. It's sensed, as we will see a bit later, and this turns on apoptosis, a very complicated process where the nucleus begins to fragment, and then you have the formation of these apoptotic bodies. They're just basically pieces of the cell breaking off, and then they are engulfed by phagocytic cells like macrophages and digested. And so the cell basically dies, of course. If this is a virus-infected cell, this is a good way to prevent the infection from spreading. So again, viruses have countered this because for viruses that take a long time to replicate, they don't want the cell to die in a couple of hours. So if you need a few days to replicate, they will inhibit apoptosis. In fact, the whole pathway of apoptosis was largely figured out by viral inhibitors that target each step. We'll see later, if this is a virus-infected cell, these apoptotic bodies are going to have viral proteins and nucleic acids in them. And when these macrophages and other kinds of phagocytic cells, like dendritic cells, when they take up these apoptotic bodies, they will sense the presence of viral proteins and nucleic acids in them and turn on the innate response. All right, so this is another way of sensing virus-infected cells. Now, on the next slide, I show you a table of some of the known viral regulators of apoptosis. And I'm going to I show you these tables not for you to memorize them, but to impress upon you all the different ways that viruses have evolved to inhibit this process. So here's the target. These are various aspects of apoptosis at which step you can regulate. So BCL2, for example, is a regulator of apoptosis in our cells. BCL2 inhibits apoptosis, basically. So this virus, adenovirus, makes a protein that's a homolog of BCL2. So as the cell starts to kick into apoptosis, the virus makes this BCL2 homolog and inhibits the process right away. And you can see other viruses also include different proteins that antagonize apoptosis in different ways. Caspases are proteases that are absolutely required for the progression through apoptosis. Many viruses encode caspase inhibitors. There are also proteins that counter oxidative stress. So when viruses infect the cells, one of the outcomes is oxidative stress, and this can be sensed, and that triggers apoptosis. And this virus encodes proteins that mask the oxidative stress. And finally, at the bottom, I added a new one. Human cytomegalovirus produces a non-coding RNA, doesn't encode any protein, that binds to a mitochondrial protein in the cell that is required for apoptosis. So the message here, again, every virus encodes some way to block apoptosis. Okay, so our first question is up. I believe it's up there already. Yep, and it is, intrinsic defenses are always present. Which of the following are included in intrinsic defenses? So that's correct, number three. Autophagy is the only one. These are, again, intrinsic means it's there, it doesn't have to be induced. Antibodies have to be induced, as we'll see on Wednesday. T cells have to be induced and tailored to the pathogen. Autophagy is always present in the uninfected cell. So that's the only one that's correct. So that's an intrinsic defense. Autophagy, apoptosis, and antiviral proteins like ApoBex that I described, and a lot more. All right, so let's talk about the innate immune system for the rest of the time. This is very complicated, and so we can spend the rest of the time on that. This is something that responds very quickly. So as intrinsic defenses are trying to handle the pathogen, we're already inducing innate defenses, just to be sure. And if intrinsic defenses can't handle them, this will take over. The innate immune system consists of cytokines. These are proteins made by the immune system that are regulating responses, as we'll see. What we call sentinel cells. These are cells that are looking for trouble. And they include dendritic cells, macrophages, and NK cells, natural killer cells, and a collection of serum proteins called complement. We'll go through each of these in a moment. This innate immune system has the potential to stop the infection before it goes further. But if it can't, it will ask for help. It will go to the adaptive immune system and say, this is the foreign invader and I need help here, and give me some help. And we'll see what the adaptive system does on Wednesday. So here's a cartoon view of it. You have our pathogen, which has gotten by the physical and chemical defenses. It has gotten by intrinsic defenses. So now it's recognized by the innate immune system. And the way it's recognized is by what are called pattern recognition receptors. And this is a big deal that has only been realized in the past 15 to 20 years or so. Now, of course, if the pathogen is not recognized as foreign, everything stops. There's no innate response. But if it is recognized as foreign, and we'll talk about how that happens, you have an innate immune response. And some of the principal parts of that, as I said, are cytokines. These are proteins that are important for defense, and we will talk about those. Dendritic cells come into play, the complement cascade, as well as NK cells. And that, in many cases, can stop viral infections before you even know that you're infected. But if it cannot, it will then inform the adaptive response, and then you will have a response tailored to the pathogen. You will have antibodies and T cells made that fit the pathogen and are specific for the pathogen. And then, if you survive the infection, you will have immune memory. And that we'll talk about next time. So let's delve into the innate immune system. So this innate immune system was not something we really understood until 1980. And a group in Germany, these two individuals, were studying Drosophila development, all right, a fruit fly. And they were making mutants. They were making mutations in the fly genes and looking for effects on the development of the fly, all right? And they had made one mutation that was in a gene, and they noticed that this gene was absolutely essential for establishing the dorsal ventral axis. So the flies were really messed up when they had this mutation. And so the legend is that Christian Nuslein Volhard said toll, right? Das war ja toll, which is like cool or crazy in German. And it became named the toll gene as a consequence, T-O-L-L. And a number of years later, this toll gene, so the gene is involved in Drosophila development, but in 96 it was found to have a role in immunity of flies to fungal infections. And these two individuals got the Nobel Prize for this work in 1995. Really important stuff. And in 1997, the genes were identified in mammals, okay? And that's where innate immunity kicks in. So toll-like receptors are key pattern recognition receptors. They are key molecules for sensing foreign products, proteins, carbohydrates, nucleic acids. So here's the initial toll gene in Drosophila, and it has a ligand with a great name called Spetzel. You know, in fruit flies, they name things really creatively. And then all the ones in mammals are shown here. There are nine in humans, so 10 in humans and 11 in mice, I think. They're all transmembrane proteins. They're type 1 proteins, so the N-terminus is outside. And they have a cytoplasmic domain called a TIR domain, which stands for toll/IL-1 receptor domain. And this is, as you will see in a moment, important for signaling, sending messages beyond the sensing. And the extracellular domain consists of a series of leucine-rich repeats. So these are stretches. The boxes show that each is a leucine-rich repeat, repeated many, many times. And the leucine, the extracellular domain of toll-like receptor 3 is shown here. It's crystal structure. And you can see each leucine repeat making a sort of pattern on this molecule. And this is a curved molecule. And this particular one recognizes RNA, and the RNA binds in the central portion of this molecule. And here on the upper right is a table showing which patterns are recognized by each of these toll-like receptors. They're important for not just recognizing viruses, they're important for bacteria and fungal infections. So you can see flagellin, the component of bacterial flagella, is recognized by toll-like receptor 5. But the ones that are important for viral RNA are TLR3, which recognizes double-stranded RNA, TLR8, I can't even see how it aligns here, 8 and 9 recognizing, 7 and 8, sorry, recognizing single-stranded RNA, and TLR9 recognizing DNA. It happens to recognize cgDNA, which is particularly rich in viral DNAs. So these were the first pattern recognition receptors. And the idea began to arise that these recognize these foreign molecules and then turn on the innate immune system. So all from working on flies, our complete understanding. I don't know when we would have picked this up. So if anyone ever asks you, why should we work on flies and worms? This is one reason, because sometimes you make accidents that are really informative. The reason I'm saying this is because a presidential candidate, was a vice presidential candidate some years ago, said, why are we working on worms and flies? And so someone should have explained to her that it's because of things like this. But I'm speaking to the converted, I presume, here. So these are this is what happens when a toll-like receptor engages a ligand. Now, for virus infections, we think the most important TLRs are the ones in the endosomal lumen. So these can be on the surface of the cell plasma membrane, but the ones important for virus detection are actually on the inside of the endosome. That's TLR 3, 7, 8, and 9. And they recognize double-stranded RNA, single-stranded RNA, or double-stranded DNA. And this, of course, can be brought here by virus infection. We talked about how when viruses infect cells, they're very frequently taken up by endocytosis, and they end up in the endosome. And what better place to detect them than TLRs in the endosome? It's perfect, right? These nucleic acids can also be delivered to endosomes by autophagosomes. Remember, the cell is wrapping up virus particles and genomes in autophagosomes, fused with lysosomes. These can be delivered to endosomes and be sensed as well. Okay? And these are recognized as foreign because they're in the endosome, particularly. The cell doesn't typically put its stuff in the endosome. So it's a matter of location because the cell, of course, has DNA and RNA. Now, what happens when these TLRs are engaged by these ligands? They start a signal transduction pathway. And they're all diagrammed here. You don't need to know these pathways. But what happens is you have a series of phosphorylation events. They all have this TIR domain I showed you in the previous slide here in the cytoplasm. That binds a number of proteins, either TRIF or MyD88, and that serves as an adapter for kinases that initiate phosphorylation cascades. The end result is activation of a transcription protein which goes in the nucleus and turns on other genes. So let's look at TLR3, which signals through TRIF, and it ends up phosphorylating a protein called IRF3. When this is phosphorylated, it forms a dimer, and then it goes into the nucleus and binds to the regulatory region around the promoter of the interferon beta gene. This is a cytokine that we will talk about in a moment. And likely, this, in the same way, detection of RNA by TLR3 can also result in localization of NF-kappa-B to the nucleus, which also contributes to interferon beta transcription, and also that of many, many other cytokines. So you can see the result of TLRs detecting foreign RNAs is the cell begins to make mRNAs for cytokines, including interferon beta. There are many, many, many cytokines that have all sorts of roles in innate immunity. We'll just touch on a few of them today. These mRNAs go out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm. They're translated, and then many of them are secreted. They're secreted proteins, and they have activity outside the cell. We'll try and touch on what some of those do today. All right, so that's TLR sensing. But as you know, some viruses don't go through the endosome, right? They just fuse at the plasma membrane and they end up in the cytoplasm. So the cell has that covered too. There are cytoplasmic helicases that are in the cytoplasm of the cell, and they're there to detect viral RNA. And there are two of them I want to tell you about. One is called RIG-I, and the other one is called MDA5. RIG-I detects single-stranded RNA with 5' phosphate. This is never made by the cell. All right, it's only a viral product, 5' phosphate. All the mRNAs in a cell, in the cytoplasm anyway, are either capped or they're tRNAs or ribosomal RNAs and not really going to be sensed by this. MDA5 detects double-stranded RNA, which again is not a typical cellular product. So in the cytoplasm, these are recognized as foreign. When they are bound to these nucleic acids, they become activated, and they too initiate a signaling pathway, which simply means phosphorylation cascades through a number of proteins, and then they end up sending transcription proteins into the nucleus. You can see c-jun, NF-kappa-B, and IRF3. They're all activated. They go in the nucleus, and you see you get transcription of interferon genes and cytokine genes. So a similar pathway to TLRs with differences, of course. But overall, the same idea. You detect something foreign. You turn on cytokine gene transcription. This one is an interesting pathway because it goes through a protein that is bound to the mitochondria. So when RIG-I and MDA5 are activated, they bind this protein called MAVs, and that starts the signaling pathway. And that's important because we'll see that some viruses antagonize that. How about DNA? Well, just last year, an interesting pathway for sensing DNA was discovered. And this is a protein in the cytoplasm called cGAS. Now, when DNA viruses infect cells, the vast majority of them replicate in the nucleus, with the exception of pox viruses, right? And they replicate in the cytoplasm. But all DNA viruses are sensed. So the idea is that there must be some leakage of DNA out of the nucleus because these sensors work in the cytoplasm. They're actually also nuclear sensors, but this was the first discovered, so I'm going to show it to you. So cGAS detects DNA in conjunction with two other proteins, IFI16 and DDX41. The point is that cGAS stands for cyclic GA synthase. Cyclic GA synthase. What it does is it takes ATP and GTP, and it makes this weird cyclic molecule. So here is an A and a G joined by this cyclic bond right there. And cyclic GAMP, okay, so it's monophosphate and it's a cyclic of both A and G, then binds a cytoplasmic protein called STING. And that starts a signaling cascade, which, guess what, ends up in transcription of genes in the nucleus encoding cytokines. Same idea as for TLRs and the cytoplasmic helicases, except this is detecting DNA in the cytoplasm. Again, the idea is that our cellular DNA is not going to be there, So if there is DNA there, it must be viral, so it's being sensed. The idea that we're using, or the cell is using, this small molecule, again, this is cyclic GAMP, is very reminiscent of the way hormones signal through second messenger. So, for example, many hormones in eukaryotic cells bind surface receptor, G-protein coupled receptors, which activates an adenylate cyclase. It makes cyclic AMP out of ATP, and that acts as a second messenger to induce a physiological response. So this is very similar, except that it's not just cyclic AMP, it's cyclic A joined to GMP. Again, this really weird molecule. So that's how DNA is sensed, or one way. These are, I'm not telling you every way that things are sensed, just to give you an overview. And the last sensing mechanism I want to tell you about is called the inflammasome. And these are structures that form in cells that detect different things from what I've told you. There's one that detects double-stranded DNA, and that's called an AIM2 inflammasome. And then there's another one called the NLRP3 inflammasome, which detects stresses like perturbation of the membrane that occurs when viruses infect cells, reactive oxygen species, and potassium efflux. These are all characteristic of virus infection. So this inflammasome detects that. This one detects double-stranded DNA. What they end up doing is inducing the synthesis of interleukins. So what happens here is that these two inflammasomes produce caspase as a consequence of their detection of either of these two conditions. In the meantime, toll-like receptors are detecting something foreign in the cell as well, and they're leading to the synthesis of these pro-IL-1 beta and pro-IL-18. These mRNAs come out in the cytoplasm, they're translated into these two proteins, and then the caspase produced by the inflammasomes cuts them and activates them, and now the mature cytokines go out and they're secreted. These are called pro-inflammatory cytokines. They cause inflammation. Exactly what that is, I'll tell you about in about 10 minutes or so. But it's just another detector in the cytoplasm, which ends up making cytokines. And the cytokines are the key to the innate response. So we have toll-like receptors, we have cytoplasmic helicases, and we have inflammasomes. These are not all important for every virus infection. Some virus infections depend on being sensed by inflammasomes, others by toll-like receptors. So there seem to be a broad variety of sensors to cover all the viruses that infect us. Now, every step that I have shown you, I haven't gone through every step, is depicted on this slide. So on the left, we have the cytoplasmic helicases, RIG-I and MDA5, and then their signaling pathway through signal transduction and transcription of cytokine genes. And on the right, we have toll-like receptors sensing DNA or RNA in the endosome, and then all the signaling that results, again, resulting in cytokine transcription. What this slide shows you is that at every one of those steps, those blue and red letters, these are viral proteins that have been identified that block these pathways. These pathways are so good. The TLRs and the cytoplasmic helicases, the inflammasomes, which aren't shown here, they're so good that if viruses didn't encode antagonists, the viruses would be eliminated. So look at them. At every step, there's an antagonist. Here is a step of IRF3 phosphorylation and dimerization. And look at all the viral proteins that inhibit it. These are different viruses where proteins have been identified that interject with just that step. And every step is affected from sensing all the way down to transcription. Let me just highlight one here, and that's the MAVS protein in the mitochondria, which I pointed out to you before. So when RIG-I or MDA5 detect RNA, they bind to a protein in the mitochondria called MAVS. These viral proteins from hepatitis C virus, another hepatitis virus, hepatitis A, human rhinovirus, they cleave MAVS off of the mitochondria. That completely blocks this whole signaling pathway. And every step of this is blocked in some way by a different virus. Now you may be asking, why are we alive, right? Because if viruses can do this, well, there's a lot of redundancy in the system. And I don't have an answer for that yet, but depending on the particular virus and in the particular immune system. And remember, not all of our immune systems are created equal. Mine is different from yours, for sure. I never get infections. I must have a good sequence of all of these proteins. Maybe some of you get infections all the time. You probably have mutations, single amino acid changes in some of these defense proteins that lets things go a little more easily. So this is really remarkable. It emphasizes this whole idea of countermeasures. Viruses have to have countermeasures against everything. All right, our next question is, which of the following allow the innate immune system to distinguish microbes from self? There you go, number one. Cytoplasmic helicases and toll-like receptors, absolutely. Antibodies do not. We haven't talked about them yet, but they are doing something different. Apoptosis is just an intrinsic response to stress. It doesn't recognize anything as foreign. Apobec, the same. So it is just number one. So the cytokines that are induced by TLRs, cytoplasmic helicases, by this sensing, one of the major classes of cytokines, and there are many different cytokines, one of the major classes is called the interferons. These were discovered in the 1950s by Isaacs and Lindemann. What they found is that if you infect chicken cells with inactivated influenza virus, then you take the supernatant from the chicken cells and put it on a fresh set of cells, those cells will be protected from infection. So they said, whatever is in the medium must interfere with infection, so they called it interferon. We now know that it is made in infected cells. We'll see how that's done. Well, you've already got a hint. When infected cells sense an infection, they make interferon. They're also made by uninfected cells. We'll see that just in a little bit. So you have, take a mucosal epithelium. This could be your respiratory tract or your gut tract. It's being infected by viruses. These cells are producing cytokines. The cytokines are the little red dots. And among those cytokines are interferons, but there are other cytokines as well. These cytokines are detected by sentinel cells. We haven't talked about the sentinels yet, but they include macrophages and dendritic cells. And the sentinels will in turn make more interferon because they say, there's a virus infection going on here. I need to make more interferon to try and block it. So interferons can be made by both virus-infected and uninfected cells. The sentinels can also sense viral nucleic acids and proteins released from the dead epithelial cells here. They can take it up and sense it by TLRs and cytoplasmic helicases. So they can also make interferon in that way. There are four main classes of interferon. There are so-called interferon alpha and beta. These are made in most cells, and they're induced by virus infection. These are called type 1 interferon. The type 2, or interferon gamma, is restricted to lymphoid cells. And then more recently discovered type 3 interferon, or interferon lambda, is mainly produced by epithelial cells. And there are many, many different kinds of each one. There are lots of different interferon alphas, for example. Now, when interferons are made, they are secreted just as any other cytokine is. They're made in the cytoplasm in the secretory pathway. Then they leave the cell and they float around in our body fluids. They bind to receptors on the surface of cells. It can be the cell that makes them or a neighboring cell. It doesn't really matter. And here are shown the receptors for the type 1 interferons, alpha, beta, and the type 2, the gamma interferons. When interferon binds to its own receptor, this activates protein kinases that are bound to the cytoplasmic domain. These phosphorylate the STAT proteins. They form complexes and go in the nucleus, and they induce the synthesis of many, many other genes. Now, these are transcription factors, basically. The STATs, in different forms, go in the nucleus. They bind near promoter regions of DNA, encoding many, many different genes. The genes that are induced by interferon are called interferon-stimulated genes, or ISGs. There are over 1,000 of them, and those are the proteins that have antiviral activity, the ISG proteins. And some of them are listed here, but there are many, many, many more. Most of them we don't understand how they are working. Just a handful have been sorted out. Let me tell you about a couple of these ISG proteins. So interferon itself does not have antiviral activity. It does not. If you mixed interferon with a virus, the virus would replicate quite happily. It is the genes that are induced by interferon, the ISGs that have antiviral activity. So this is just a generic replication scheme showing you some of the sites of activity. The interferon-stimulated genes are shown in red. So here is an interesting one called viperin. Viperin blocks virus budding. So it works on envelope viruses by interacting with what are called lipid rafts. These are specialized domains of the plasma membrane that are required for budding of some viruses. Tetherin is another one that prevents viruses from leaving the cell when they're budding. We'll look at this one in a moment. The MX protein interferes with viral RNA transcription or replication, two different steps. ISG15 is a small protein that is conjugated to viral proteins and leads them to the degradation pathway, to the proteasome. So this targets viral proteins for degradation. PKR, we talked about a couple of lectures ago. This is the kinase that phosphorylates EIF2-alpha and leads to translational inhibition. So that's an interferon-induced gene. And finally, RNA cell is an interferon-induced gene that cuts up viral RNAs. So these are just a handful of the thousand and more interferon-stimulated genes that we know of. This is just a little more detail on this very interesting pair of ISGs. There's an ISG in cells called 2' 5' oligoadenylate synthetase. So again, it's induced by interferon. It's inactive, but when it binds viral double-stranded RNA, it's activated, and then what it does is make oligo A out of ATP. The oligo A in turn activates RNA cell, which is another ISG, which is inactive as it's made. When it becomes active, then it cuts up viral RNA. So there's a lot of control in many of these proteins just to make sure they're not doing the wrong thing. Here is tetherin, a really interesting ISG that's put in the plasma membrane. And what it does is basically grab virus particles as they're trying to bud. So here's a retrovirus virion that's trying to bud from the cell. And the tetherin grabs it, and eventually this whole thing gets endocytosed and degraded. This is actually an antiviral for a number of envelope viruses, including retroviruses, Ebola, a couple of others. However, viruses counter it. That's why HIV and Ebola can replicate. For example, the HIV-1 protein called VPU blocks the display of tetherin on the cell surface, so it can't grab the HIV virions. There's an Ebola virus protein that also antagonizes tetherin as well. So again, at every step, and I'm not telling you all the antagonisms, but at every step, there's a viral antagonist. Another interferon-stimulated protein, which is quite interesting, is called nitric oxide synthase. This is an enzyme which takes the amino acid arginine and makes nitric oxide. This is a highly oxidizing chemical, and what this does is it reacts with proteins and inactivates them. So this nitric oxide synthase is typically made by immune cells. So here's an infected cell monolayer. The cells know they're being infected, they're releasing cytokines. Some of those cytokines' job is to attract immune cells like this to them. And these immune cells are making nitrates, nitric oxide. And those nitric oxides are killing the cell and, in effect, restricting viral replication. So it's a very focused, targeted lysis of cells. Now, this happens to be one of the things we do in my lab, so I thought I would just tell you one of the experiments that we have done. As I said, there are lots of interferon-stimulated genes, and we did this experiment to ask which one of them inhibit poliovirus. So we took 350 of them, and we cloned each one into a plasmid to express it, and we put this in cells, and then we infect with poliovirus. And this is the result of that assay of 350 different ISGs. You can see most of them have no effect on virus replication at all. Those are all the dots in the middle here. And here we have in the bottom the ones that inhibit poliovirus replication. And a handful of them are very, very inhibitory. They include TRIM25 and APOL6. And so this has focused us in on three or four of these ISGs, and we're trying to figure out how they inhibit polio replication. And many different laboratories are doing this with their own virus. And every virus is inhibited by a very different combination of these ISGs. Now, all of this sounds great. The interferon system is antiviral, but it's also dangerous. It induces the expression of many of these proteins, ISGs, that I've told you about, that are active in many cells. And they have, as well as positive effects on eliminating infection, they have deleterious effects as well. They cause fever, chills, nausea, and malaise. In fact, when you get these symptoms from a virus infection, you can thank interferon and other cytokines for doing that. They are the side effects that you pay for clearing a virus infection. So every virus infection results in interferon production, and that's why this so-called flu-like symptoms, which are fever, chills, nausea, malaise, is really not just flu. It's pretty much every virus that induces interferon, because the interferons and associated cytokines cause these symptoms. In fact, some virus infections are treated by giving people interferon. So hepatitis C virus infection, for example, is treated with injected interferon. And the side effects are terrible. These individuals get all of these side effects every day because they're getting constant injections of interferon. So this is clearly not the optimal therapy, but until something better comes along, that's what we have. Now, just with the sensing and the intrinsic mechanisms that I told you about, there are viral countermeasures to interferon. So here we're looking at the production, the binding of interferon to receptors, which leads to signaling and the production of interferon-stimulated genes. All right. So again, the blue and the red are viral proteins that interfere at every step. There are even viruses that, do I have it highlighted here? Yes. There are viruses that make molecules that look like interferon. They bind interferon receptors and nothing happens. So the receptors get all bound up by these homologs and there's no ISGs produced. And some viruses even make soluble interferon receptors that float around in your fluids and sop up all of the interferon so it can't signal. And again, at every step of the way, even transcription and the cytokines themselves, the interferon-stimulated genes themselves are inhibited by all of these viral gene products. And this is just 15 of them. You know, there are over 1,000 and they're probably all inhibited in some way. It's really remarkable. This is an arms race back and forth between virus and host. The next question is, how do interferons limit viral replication? Number three. That's right. Interferons induce ISGs, which stands for interferon-stimulated genes. They don't inhibit. So interferons don't inhibit anything on their own. They induce things that inhibit. They don't inhibit translation. They don't inhibit toll-like receptors. They may, but that's not how they inhibit virus replication. So they don't really. They cause symptoms. They cause fever, malaise, aches, and so forth, but they don't actually damage cells. Yeah, if they killed the cells, that would be an antiviral mechanism, but that's not the way it works. All right, so that is interferon. Then let's talk a little bit about the sentinel cells, which are part of the innate immune response. And this includes dendritic cells, which are shown on the left here. So they look like dendrites, or they have these long processes that look like dendrites. That's why they're called dendritic cells, but they're not nerve cells. Macrophages and natural killer cells. These are natural killer cells, the yellow ones here, attacking an infected cell. So these cells are always circulating in various parts of your body, looking for trouble, all right? Patrolling constantly your mucosal surfaces, your body cavities, your blood. They are looking for an infection, and when they find it, they report it. Dendritic cells were first called Langerhans cells. So you may still see this in the literature by Paul Langerhans, but Ralph Steinman, who's shown here, and his colleague Cohn called them dendritic cells in 1973. Steinman was an investigator at Rockefeller. He died not too long ago. He's the only person who receives a Nobel Prize after dying, because the Nobel Committee actually didn't know he had died. So they awarded it to him, and it was this big debate, and they said, well, we didn't know he had died, so it's okay. But if you're dead, you cannot get a Nobel Prize posthumously. So we talked about him with some of the people that worked in his lab on my podcast 157. So there are lots of different kinds of dendritic cells in our bodies. There are what we call blood dendritic cells. They tend to patrol the blood. Tissue dendritic cells. And you don't need to know the the precise differences. They're all depending on cell surface markers. But what you should know is that dendritic cells patrol mucosal surfaces. And look at this purple one here. I think this is the neatest thing. It's sticking its dendrite through between the two mucosal cells, and it's sampling the contents of the intestinal lumen. This is really neat. And also your epithelial cells of different places. And basically, they're always hanging out there. And if there's a virus-infected cell, they will sense the cytokines produced by that cell. In fact, that's what will attract them to the infected cell in the first place. And then as the cells break up, they will take up the dead and dying cells and then say, yeah, this is viral. And some of them make a lot of interferon. So there are some cells called plasmacytoid dendritic cells that just pump out a lot of interferon at the site of infection to try and limit the infection. Others go to the lymph node. That's what this structure is here. And they talk to T cells. So the lymph nodes, you know, has B cell zones and T cell zones where B and T cells develop, mature. And in the T cell zone, they take the proteins that they found at the mucosal surface and they show it to a T cell and they say, is this foreign? And the T cell looks at it and it makes an evaluation. And if it's foreign, then the T cells start to mature into effector cells that can go back out and attack the virus-infected cells. So eventually, some of these T cells will come out. This on the right is a picture of a dendritic cell, which is labeled with green fluorescence, talking to a T cell, which is in blue, not too far from a blood vessel. This is in the lymph node. So dendritic cells patrol. They pick up material and bring it back to the lymph node. They also can make interferon and many other cytokines. Now, this is on the left is what's called an immature dendritic cell. This is what it looks like until it's encountered antigen. So these cells have toll-like receptors on their surfaces. They have cytoplasmic helicases. They have cytokine receptors. They have major histocompatibility class II molecules inside of their endosomes. And basically, they will sense viruses or viral proteins. They're very phagocytic. They take up a lot of particles. They will sense cytokines produced by infected cells. Remember the cytokines made by the sensing. And they also will pick up parts of dead and dying cells, say, made by apoptosis. When they sense any of this stuff by their sensors, they become activated. Then they become what looks like a real dendritic cell. They make these long processes. This gives them a lot of surface area. They then take any viral protein that they have picked up and they chop it up into peptides, which they put up in class II molecules, and they put this on their surface. They go in the lymph node, and they present these peptides to naive T cells. And they also provide cytokines that help the naive T cells do their thing. And the T cell will say, this is not foreign, no problem, and then that's the end. Or if it's foreign peptide from a virus, they will then mature into an effector cell, like a cytotoxic T cell, which will go out back to the site of infection and try and kill the virus-infected cells. So we're going to talk more about T cells and the adaptive response next time, but you have to remember that these dendritic cells are a major link between innate and adaptive responses. Yes?
Is this how T cells are infected
with HIV? Dendritic cells can take up HIV. They actually bind. They have a lectin on the surface of dendritic cells, which binds HIV. And then they migrate to the lymph node because that's part of their normal pattern. And in the lymph node are the T cells where HIV replicates. So it's a perfect Trojan horse scenario, right? So the virus is being given a ride to exactly where it wants to go. But it doesn't replicate in them. Other viruses will actually replicate in dendritic cells and destroy their function. Yeah. Okay, another cellular component, another sentinel, are called NK cells, natural killer cells. These recognize virus-infected cells in a different way than what we'll talk about for T cells next time. These have receptors on their surfaces. They're called inhibitory and activating receptors. And if they detect, they're always moving around your cells and touching various cells with these receptors. And if they find an uninfected target cell, their inhibitory receptor engages MHC1, major histocompatibility class 1 molecules. The activating receptor will recognize a ligand on the surface of these cells. This can be a number of different proteins. This cell will not be lysed because these interactions negate the killing activity of the NK cell. In many virus-infected cells, MHC-1 is downregulated. The MHC-1, of course, will present viral peptides to T cells, and virus doesn't want that, so it downregulates it. The NK cell will sense that MHC-1 has been downregulated, and then it will kill this cell. So a cell with downregulated MHC-1 and normal activating ligand will get killed. The activating interaction is needed for the NK cell to kill. And then you have another situation where some virus infections don't mess with MHC-1, but they upregulate the activating receptor for other reasons. And the NK cell can recognize that and kill it as well. So these are part of the innate response. Again, they're not pathogen specific, but they recognize what's called missing self or induced self. Now, as you might guess, NK cell killing is antagonized by many different viruses. So here's a diagram with an NK cell here and a target cell here that's been infected. And I just told you about how the NK cell senses the presence of MHC class 1. Well, some viruses make a homolog of MHC class 1. It doesn't have the same function, but to the NK cell, it looks like a class 1. So the NK cell doesn't kill the cell. So that's a mimetic. Some viruses downregulate and substitute MHC-1 with something else that the NK cell can't distinguish. Some viruses can block the activating receptor in various ways so that, again, the activating receptor on the NK cell has to interact with the ligand on the cell in order for killing to happen, and viruses block that. There are cytokines that are needed for NK killing, and these can be blocked by viruses. And finally, some viruses can block the inhibitory receptor as well. So every step of this is blocked by some viral activity. It's absolutely amazing. The last component of the innate system is complement. This is a collection of serum proteins, many, many different proteins, which are present in us all the time. Could also, you know, could almost consider an intrinsic defense. And these are important for getting rid of virus infections in various ways, both early in infection and even late when we make antibodies, because some of the complement-mediated effects depend on having antibody to the virus. So this is just one pathway for detecting virus. There's a protein which is part of the complement pathway called C1Q. C1Q forms this multimeric complex, which can detect antibodies bound to the surface of cells. So when cells are infected, often antibodies are sticking to them. The C1 complex recognizes that, then you have a whole cascade of processing reactions and new proteins emerging. The result is the formation of what's called a membrane attack complex. This is basically a pore placed in the plasma membrane that kills the cell. So the complement says, this cell is infected, I gotta kill it. This is this one pathway. And there are two other ways that complement can detect infection that are independent of antibody. Sometimes this component C1Q can actually coat virus particles, and then those are more effectively taken up by phagocytic cells like macrophages. And yes, there are viral modulators of complement as well. Complement can poke holes in cells, as I've just told you. Complement cascade can also result in the production of cytokines, very much like the cytokines produced when cells sense infections by TLRs, for example. They can opsonize viruses, as I just told you. And another thing that is not really related to what we talk about, but it can solubilize immune complexes. Next time we'll talk about how if you have a lot of virus replication and a really good immune response, a really good antibody response, you can get immune complexes formed. And these can be dangerous in tissues with tiny capillaries like your kidney or your brain. And complement, one of complement's functions is to break those up so they're not pathological. So another really important innate component. And the next question is, what roles do dendritic cells play in viral defense? Like a smattering of everything. Okay, except for number four, which is good because that certainly isn't true. DCs don't lyse virus-infected cells. They don't really destroy virus particles. They can take them up and sense them. They can take up pieces of dying cells with virus antigens in them, but that's not really what they do. They sense infected cells and produce interferons. Of all the choices here, that's the best one. They don't only instruct the adaptive response. That's certainly a major part of what they do, as I've told you, and we'll talk about that more later and next time, but they don't only do that, and they don't lyse virus-infected cells. Now, all this cytokine production, cytokines being interferons and all the other cytokines, the interleukins, the chemokines, and I haven't told you about many of them, these cause inflammation, all right, or the inflammatory response. And the inflammation is the following: redness, pain, heat, and swelling. Have you ever had any of that? Then you've had a virus infection, you've had inflammation. By the way, a Roman encyclopedist, Celsus, this Roman, he wrote an encyclopedia of medicine, and he was the first to recognize these symptoms of inflammation. He called them rubor, dolor, calor, and tumor: redness, pain, heat, and swelling. This is a consequence of increased blood flow, increased capillary permeability, influx of phagocytic cells, and tissue damage. That's what causes these symptoms. All of this is a consequence of cytokine production. The idea is you have an infected area. These cells make cytokines, dendritic cells come in, make more cytokines. They attract other cells that are going to clear the infection. And to do that, you need to make the capillaries permeable. And some of these cytokines, as a consequence, also raise your temperature. So that's what's going on here. Now, all the cytokines we've talked about can be put into three classes. They're pro-inflammatory, like IL-1, tumor necrosis factor, et cetera. These promote these redness, pain, swelling, and temperature, and so forth. They are anti-inflammatory, so when the infection is over, you have to turn the system down. So these are regulatory cytokines. And then there are chemokines that are produced to recruit immune cells to the infected area. So the way that dendritic cells come in the first place to an infected area is through chemokines that are produced from those cells. So initially you have a respiratory infection, say you're making chemokines locally, but these get into your circulation, and that's why you get fever. For example, the pro-inflammatory cytokines eventually make it to your brain and make you sleepy, and they go to other areas and induce fever. Fever is a very common reaction to virus infection. We think it helps restrict virus replication, but we're not quite sure. There isn't really good data to support that. So that's why you, in part, feel fever. So the sleepiness, lethargy, muscle pain, no appetite, nausea, these are all caused by cytokines that have left the initial site of replication and are going to different parts of your body, bone marrow, liver, and brain, and so forth. Tumor necrosis factor is one of the earliest cytokines produced, and it binds to a receptor on the surface of cells, and this binding can have three different consequences depending on what proteins associate with the receptor. That can cause apoptosis. So TNF can kill cells. Again, you kill virus-infected cells. It can induce necrosis, which is another kind of programmed cell death involving different proteins. Or it can turn on the production of even more cytokines to amplify the response. So this is just one example. Many of these cytokines have circuits. There are receptors for them on the cell surface. And that binding has a lot of different consequences. Now imagine this is an infected area of the body. We have the lymph system and a blood vessel down here. And here is, they're in between somewhere, there's some infected cells, and those virus are producing antigen. These cells, of course, are going to attract dendritic cells. The dendritic cells are going to be making lots of cytokines and chemokines to attract other cells to the area. You're going to be making interferons. Complement is going to have a role as well. The result is the bloodstream becomes permeabilized. The blood capillaries become permeabilized so that immune cells can come in, neutrophils, basophils, macrophages, to try and clear this infection. So that's going to give you a lot of fluid coming out of capillaries. The swelling, the influx of cells makes the area swell as well. And then, of course, the dendritic cells will go to the lymph node, instruct the T cells. The T cells are going to come back and make more damage in this area as well. So this is why you get inflammation. You have all these things happening. You have cells coming into the infected area, and you have biological activities of various cytokines. Inflammation is good. Even though you feel bad, it's good because it means that your innate and adaptive systems are communicating. And this is why many viral genomes include antagonists of this response, especially the big DNA viruses, because they don't want to have a good adaptive response. If they can suppress inflammation by suppressing the cytokine response, you won't make a good antibody response or T cell response, and the virus will be able to persist longer. So many viruses don't make a good adaptive response because they don't stimulate inflammation. They either don't replicate well or they inhibit the cytokines themselves. And these are typically viruses that don't kill cells. If you don't kill a cell, its products will not be picked up by dendritic cells, and you won't get as good an adaptive response. You won't get as good inflammation. You won't get a good adaptive response. And viruses that don't kill cells, and we're going to be talking about these later, the herpes viruses, for example, they typically cause persistent infections. Again, if you don't kill the cell is not sensed very well by the dendritic cells. You don't get a good cytokine response. You don't get good inflammation. You don't get good antibody response. So these non-cytopathic viruses tend to cause what we call persistent infections. So inflammatory response tells you that the innate and the adaptive systems are talking, and that's good. If you don't have an inflammatory response, you're going to have a poor adaptive response. And this is one reason why in many vaccines that don't replicate, so there are many inactivated vaccines that do not replicate, therefore they cannot kill cells, we add an adjuvant. We add a chemical that by itself causes inflammation. It causes the production of cytokines, which will lead to the influx of cells and so forth, including dendritic cells. That makes you get a better antibody response to that vaccine. And we'll talk about an example of a viral vaccine that failed, actually, because it couldn't induce a good antibody response through this innate system. So our last question, what is inflammation? That's right, it's all of the above. Heat, swelling, redness, pain, increased blood flow, capillary permeability, influx of cells, tissue damage, absolutely a consequence of cytokine production that causes inflammation, mainly caused by cytopathic viruses, viruses that kill cells and release products. Do you think inflammation can have a non-viral cause? Could it have a non-infectious cause? Yes, absolutely. When you injure yourself, you often have a local inflammatory response because you're stimulating cytokine production. Cells are coming in to try and fix the damage. Absolutely. It's not simply caused by infectious agents. So this is where I leave you. We've got an infected mucosal surface. The cells are making cytokines. The dendritic cells are in there, attracted by the cytokines. They pick up pieces of the dead and dying cells. They get activated. They go into the lymph node, and they present these antigens, and then if it's viral, you will have the production of antibodies and T cells. And this is what we're going to talk about next time, the adaptive immune system. But you have to remember how closely connected it is to the innate system through these dendritic cells. And the last slide, second to last, every one of these cytokines, TNF, interferon, various interleukins that I haven't told you about, interleukin 8, 10, they all have antagonists. There are viruses that interfere with their production, with their action. There are homologs of the cytokines and the receptors, and they're interfering with the signaling. So at every step of every innate, intrinsic, and adaptive response, which we'll see next time, there's viral antagonism. Viruses must encode at least one regulator. And again, it's an arms race. You would think that because viruses antagonize every step, they would win all the time, but they don't. Some of us have really good cytokines and others have less good. Sometimes you get less virus initiating the infection, and that may make a difference as well. So there are lots of factors that come into play to determine. So obviously, it's not a given that either the virus or the host is going to win. It depends on a lot of factors.